Father, we thank you for tonight in the name of Jesus. We give you all the glory, we give you all the praise and adoration. Holy Spirit divine, without you we can do nothing. Spirit of the living God, even as we go to the pages of the scriptures, unravel the mysteries of the word unto us. Open the fields, help us to understand the days and the times in which we live. Open our understanding to get clarity of your ways, that we will number our days with wisdom. In your name alone will be glorified. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Good night to all our brothers and sisters on Zoom joining us tonight. I want you to pick up your Bible, pick up your notebook, pick up your pen, your pencil, and don't lie on the bed, sit in a chair so you don't sleep off, because there's a lot to learn. I'm going to need my two Bible readers. I'm going to ask Mr. Antonio to read all the scriptures in Revelations. I'm teaching the end of Revelation chapter 6, and then Revelation chapter 7. And then all other scriptures, Victoria, you will read other scriptures for me. Revelation chapter 6, verse 14.
Reading, and the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places.
Now, this is the place we got to last week. And I explained to you that islands will move from one place to another. So you will still be sitting on the same island. Then you wake up in the morning and you realize you're not in the Atlantic Ocean, somewhere in the Pacific. And the trees around you, the animals, everything is changed, the sky. And the Bible makes us to understand that the sky, the blue sky, will be rolled away. Now, the Bible did not tell us when the blue skies is rolled away, what kind of sky we're going to have. That is something we have to find out. It didn't tell us, but the main sky, the blue sky, is going to roll away, and then some kind of sky will be there. But the Bible is very clear. It tells us in Revelation chapter 14 that the sky will be rolled away. And it tells us in Isaiah 34, verse 4, that the sky will be rolled away. I want you to go to Isaiah 34 and read verse 4. Isaiah 34, verse 4.
And all the hosts of heaven shall be dissolved, and the heavens shall be rolled together as a scroll, and all their hosts shall fall down, as the leaf falleth off from the vine, and as a falling fig from the fig tree.
So there we go. We find in the scripture that not only is it in Revelation, is in the book of what? Isaiah, that the sky will be what? Rolled off completely. And something else will show up, but the Bible did not tell us what's going to show up when the sky is rolled off. And we are told that the islands will be moved out of what? Will be moved out of place. It's going to be a very fearsome time that the whole world is going to face. And this is the time. Now, let me show you another scripture. Go to 2 Peter chapter 3. What I'm doing is I'm allowing scripture to interpret scripture. That is how you study the Bible. You read one part of the scripture and you will find another part of the scripture that explains the same thing you are reading, confirming it. The Bible interprets itself. I want you to read 2 Peter and I write the scripture down. It's not in the outline. So write the scripture down. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 10 to verse 11.
But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness?
Now, If you look at that same scripture, it tells us that the heavens shall be what? Shall pass away with great noise. Now, Peter takes us to another level by saying that it's not just going to roll away, but in rolling away, it will come with a great noise. Now, a little thunder and lightning scares people. Now, can you imagine a whole carpet, the lost carpet, being rolled away in the sky? We don't know how long it's going to take to roll it. We don't know where it's being rolled to, and we don't know what comes after. It's going to be a scary time, real scary time for animals and human beings alike, because if you're a bird and you're flying in the sky and you see the sky being rolled away, you could panic, and that be the end of you. It's going to be a scary time. Imagine being on a plane, and the plane is flying, and all of a sudden, you see the sky being rolled away. The pilot is going to panic. He's going to crash the plane. So a lot of horrible things are going to happen that time. Now, I want you to go to Luke chapter 21. Luke chapter 21, and I want you to read from verse 25 to 26.
And there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars.
Stop there. There shall be signs in the sun, signs in the moon, and signs in the stars. Why? Because they are witnesses. Remember, I've taught this before, that God created the sun, the moon, and the stars as what? Witnesses. They mark times and what? And seasons. Now, already NASA have seen changes in the sun. That there was about 3 years ago, there was actually a mini earthquake in the sun, and the sun began to spew like a volcanic eruption with its fire and everything. And they were worried that that was going to affect the sky, the atmosphere, and everything. But it didn't. There are all signs to tell us what to come. There are things that are happening. They're worried. NASA is very worried about the asteroids and the meteors and things that they're very worried, because so many asteroids are passing too close to the planet Earth. And they're saying that it's not a matter of if it happens, but when it happens. But we don't need all of that. We got scripture to tell us that these things are bound to happen. And as we see the warning signs coming from scripture and from scientists and everything, we need to know and understand we live in the very last days. One of the most unfortunate things is we're living in the time in the church age that people don't hear messages like this. You don't hear teachings like this, because everybody wants to be hyped and everybody wants to be somebody who wants to do something. And that is the focus of the church right now. And it's unfortunate, because when we build like that, a time is going to come that you need to know the word of God and you need to have clarity. One of the reasons why people prophesy and miss prophecy is because they don't know the word of God. That's the problem, because it's a dangerous thing to be in the prophetic and not know the word of God. Write this down. One of the most dangerous things also to do in the prophetic is to try to push current events into scripture. You never push current events into scripture. You never do that. You allow scripture to interpret itself into current events, not the other way around. If you do that and you tend to use that to prophesy, you will find that as a matter of time passes by, your prophecy too will fall on the ground. And it baffles me how people never learn. And most of what we call prophetic in these last days is just to get attention. If you look into scripture, the people that were in the prophetic, what they did was they would hear God, and they would hear God with clarity and with surety and everything. But these days, somebody will have a big pizza and everything, wake up and have a dream and things, and then God revealed this to me, blah, 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 and start talking without checking it up and checking it up and checking it up with the Holy Spirit, because they want to be heard and they want to be what? Seen. That's the two problems. It comes from the helm of self. You want to be heard and you want to be what? You want to be seen. And because people want to be heard and they want to be seen so quickly, they put out things that it's not meant to be done. And then they then have to come and explain themselves. I watched how COVID-19 came and how people were rushing and said, COVID-19 will be out, will be over by April. We cast that demon. I won't pray like that. No, because I know that when judgment comes, every time God releases the judgment, allows or releases the judgment on earth, the people of God will pray. God will fulfill his timetable. For example, we know that the children of Israel were in the wilderness for 40 years. Then you also know that when they got into the land, they began to sin against God. And God, the Bible says in the book of Judges, chapter 12, that God gave them into the hands of the Philistines for how many years? Another 40 years. And then they cried and they prayed, oh, God, deliver us. So God then raised Samson to deliver them. So you see, God is a God of order and a God of pattern. I can't believe that people don't study the scripture. If they have studied scripture, they will notice that there are situations you cannot just pray and change it. Otherwise, Daniel would have prayed and changed captivity. Ezekiel would have prayed and changed captivity just so. And people get themselves worked up and everything. No. When the time and the season. So, for example, you have a situation in Barbados. You're walking around and your placards is not going to change anything. Because in the days that you should have prayed and changed things, you slept. So you will go through. Now you must now learn how to survive in Babylon. That's the only way. So Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were not praying against being in Babylon. Jeremiah had already warned them. He said, build houses, marry, have children in the land of Babylon because you're not coming out soon. So you must understand prophetic patterns and not just talk when you want to feel like talking and shouting. Because you're talking and shouting, it's not going to change anything. You must be in the timetable of God. Continue. Luke 21, verse 26.
Men's heart filling them for fear.
Now, I want you to start. Start from 25 again.
And there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars, and upon the earth, distress of nations.
And upon the earth, distress of nations. There's never been a time where stress and distress is on the increase. Telling you, we're getting close. Distress of nations continue.
With perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring.
The sea and the waves roaring. Now, how many of you have heard the stories about global warming and the volume of the sea is increasing? It's prophecy. It's just there. We're not even there yet. So, for example, if you're living on an island and the volume of the sea is increasing because the ice cap and both the South Pole and the North Pole are melting, it means islands are in danger. Already there are islands in Pacific where the sea has just swallowed them up. You want to know? Just go to the seashore and know. Pay attention. Observe where the sea used to be. It is pushing in and pushing in and pushing in. The sea roaring and the waves. Continue.
Men's heart feeling them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth. For the powers of heaven shall be shaken.
For the powers of heaven shall be shaken. Revelation chapter 6, verse 15.
Reading. And the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the chief captains, and the mighty men, and every bondman, and every freeman, hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains.
Now, it's funny that world leaders and governors and chiefs and rich people and everything will leave their palaces and mansions and then go to hide themselves in caves because of the things that is coming. I want you to still picture, this is in the time of the tribulation. This is in the time of what? The tribulation. And the world is in total chaos. Now, bear in mind that there was a white horse where they say world peace. And then there was war, the red horse. And then the red horse, then followed by what? The pale horse, which brought hunger. And then after the pale horse was what? The black horse, which brought what? Death. So now, culminating everything together with the sky rolling away and islands moving around and men going to hide themselves in mountains. Now, when you're on an island of Barbados, I don't know where you're going to hide because we don't have any mountains. You might have to go to, what do we call that place in St. Thomas? That cave thing. Harrison Cave. But then, already, they sold Harrison Cave to a Jamaican company. So you have to pay to get in. And we know Harrison Cave leaks with water. So you don't know whether the water is going to come out and swallow you up. There is no hiding place in this island of Barbados. The only hiding place is a secret place of the Most High God. Read 16.
And said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb.
See, these kings and these leaders, they knew something. Now, if I gather all of you and say, okay, let's go out and pray, and we're going to prophesy to stones and we're going to prophesy to rocks, then I get called as a witch and a wizard. Then why are you talking to and prophesying on rocks and doing this and everything and things like that? But notice, these kings and these people understood that rocks have ears. They can hear. Jesus said, if you have faith like a mustard seed, you will say unto the mountain, be thou removed, and the mountain will be removed. Now, for the mountain to be removed, the mountain must first hear the command. So these kings were deep in witchcraft. They knew. They understood spiritual things, that everything God has created has the ability to what? To hear. So they made a command. They said to the mountains and the rock, fall on us. Hide us from the face of him. They told the mountain to hide them from the face of him that sitteth on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. That's funny. The wrath of the Lamb. It's a lamb. A lamb can't do you anything. A lamb cannot bite you. A lamb doesn't have horns to hit you. So how can the wrath of a lamb. What's the Bible talking about? Now, this is linguistics. For example, in geography, you are told the higher you go, the cooler it becomes, right? How many of you know that? That the higher you go, the cooler it becomes. I thought you're getting closer to the sun. So the higher you go, the hotter it should be. But then, no, the higher you go, the hot, the cooler it becomes. That's why if somebody comes out of the plane, or if a plane suffers a depression and the windows get broken, the people in the plane are going to feel frozen because the air in that atmosphere is very, very, very cold. You would have thought that place would be very, 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 very hot because it is what? Closer to the sun. Now, that's the same language that been used to refer that the wrath of the lamb. What it says is, lambs don't normally get angry. They don't have wrath. Lambs can't bite you. They can't do anything. But there's a lamb that will have wrath. Because he's not just a lamb. He's also the lion of what? The tribe of Judah. Verse 17.
For the great day of his wrath is come. And who shall be able to stand?
Now, I wanted to show you that it is not the first time people have actually cried onto rocks to hide them and to protect them. I want you to go to Hosea chapter 10 verse 8. Hosea chapter 10 verse 8.
The high places also of Avon.
Start from verse 6.
It shall be also carried unto Assyria for a present to King Jareb. Ephraim shall receive shame, and Israel shall be ashamed of his own counsel. As for Samaria, her king is cut off as the foam upon the water. The high places also of Avon, the sin of Israel, shall be destroyed. The thorn and the thistle shall come up on their altars, and they shall say to the mountains, cover us, and to the hills, fall on us.
Do you see that? They said to the mountains, in the day when the Assyrian army came and destroyed Samaria, Ephraim, and Israel, they went to the mountains and said, hide us, fall on us from the judgment that is to come. So it has been done what? Before. It has been done before. And I want you to go to Isaiah chapter 2, and I want you to read from verse 10 to verse 12. Isaiah chapter 2, verse 10 to 12.
Enter into the rock and hide thee in the dust for the fear of the Lord and for the glory of his majesty. The lofty looks of man shall be humbled, and the haughtiness of men shall be bowed down, and the Lord alone shall be exalted in that day. For the day of the Lord of hosts shall be upon everyone that is proud and lofty, and upon everyone that is lifted up, and he shall be brought low.
You'll see that. So man will be brought to nothing. Your status will not matter. Your social status and your qualifications and what I've done and I am days and everything, that will be meaningless. Because God will brought man to a piece of bread. Now, I want you to go to Luke chapter 23, and I want you to start reading from verse 27.
And there followed him a great company of people and of women. Which also bewailed and lamented him. But Jesus, turning unto them, said, daughters of Jerusalem, weep not for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For behold, the days are coming in the which they shall say, blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bear, and the paps which never gave suck. Then shall they begin to say to the mountains, fall on us, and to the hills, cover us. For if they do these things in a green tree, what shall be done in the dry?
Now this is Jesus speaking. Now, this is the story when he was arrested and was going being taken for crucifixion. And the Bible says the woman began to weep. They began to weep. And Jesus said, don't weep for me, you know. Weep for yourselves and for your children. What? That's prophetic language. You say, weep for the nation of Israel and its descendants. Because as you rejected me, who is a green tree, and you, a dry tree, if they're going to crucify me, if the Roman Empire is going to crucify me and torture me, I want you to understand, you that is a dry tree, that the revised Roman Empire will not spare you. That in the day of judgment, you will cry to the mountains, fall on us, and to the hills cover us. So it's not only John that spoke about it. It's not only Isaiah that spoke about it. It's not only Hosea that spoke about it. Jesus spoke about it. That's how you study scripture. Now, as I'm teaching, I also want you to pay attention and to find out and know that scripture interprets what itself. There is no private interpretation of what? Of scripture. Now, I want you to go to Revelation chapter 7 and start reading from verse 1.
Reading. And after these things, I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor on any tree.
I don't want to be here. Now, watch this. It says, and after these things, after what things? After everything, after the islands have moved and the mountains and the sky has rolled up, After the so-called peace have turned out to be war, and the war has brought famine, and the famine has brought death, And remember, how many percentage of the world perished in those wars? 25% perished. And I told you that if COVID-19 were struggling to bury people in the world for COVID-19, how much more would the world struggle to bury 25% of the world's population? It's just going to be a horrible, horrible time. And then the Bible says in Revelation chapter 7 that after these things, well, we're not done yet. No, we're not done yet. After these things, I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth. Now, that's prophetic language. Every time you read in the Bible and the Bible says four corners of the earth, it means four cardinal points, north, south, east, and west. Now, the second thing you must learn there is there was an assigned angel for every cardinal point. There were four angels, four corners of the earth, holding the four wings of the earth, telling you that there are assigned angels who are responsible for what happens in the north, what happens in the south, what happens in the east, and what happens in the west. And they control the winds. Now, let me teach you the ways of the watchman on this verse 1. The first thing you will learn is there are four angels that control the four cardinal points. The second thing is the four angels control the four winds. So, for example, you're learning how to pray and to pray effectively by his word. You're having a storm come against you. One of the things you do is a watchman must be observant. In which direction is the storm coming? And if the storm that is coming, is it coming with water, with rain and everything? What can I do to fight against this rain? Dry wind. Which direction is the dry wind coming from? Then you make a direct appeal to heaven. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus, because according to the word of God, whatsoever thing you ask the Father in my name, by the power of the Holy Spirit, it shall be given unto you. Now, that's how you pray. So you pray to the Father. You do not pray to angels. I repeat, you do not pray to what? Angels. You do not pray to Mary. You do not pray to Peter. You do not pray to James. You do not pray to John. You don't pray to Elijah. You don't pray to Moses. You pray to the Father in the name of Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit. That's biblical prayer. Who strengthens you to pray? The Holy Ghost. He strengthens you to pray so that you'll be able to pray correctly to the Father in the name of Jesus. Because there is no name given among men whereby men shall be saved. At the mention of the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus is the Lord. That's how you pray. So you pray and you make a request to the Father and say, Father, I make a request concerning the storm that is coming towards us. Let the north winds, or let the opposite winds that are dry, I command, and my Father, would you release the angel that control the winds from the north? And say, oh Lord, by the appeal of the blood of the Lamb and by the access I have to enter into your court with boldness, let the angel that controls the north that has the dry wind send the dry wind against the storm. And let the storm change direction. That's prayer, because you're praying according to his word. That's the way you pray, with understanding. When you read in scriptures, the Bible have different facets to it. It's not, I don't want you to learn the Bible and thinking, we study Revelation, so everything has to be in the future. No, Jesus told John, write the things that will be now. The things that happened before, the things that will be now, and the things that will happen in the future. Past, present, and what? Future. Jesus is the same word yesterday, today, and what? And forever. So there's something to learn that will help you in the now. It's not all just future. Okay. Now let me move on. Go to verse 3. Verse 2.
And I saw another angel
ascending
from the east, having the seal of the living God.
Stop there. I thought when we read in verse 1, there was an angel of the east. There was an angel of what? North, south, east, and west. But this angel that was coming from the east is different. And the sense that he's different because he's ascending from the east. He's not descending from the east. Which means this angel is an angel of the altar. He's an angel. Now notice that this angel has the seal of the living God. Which means the rank of this angel is higher than the four angels that control what? The winds. Now, how does tornadoes happen? For tornadoes to happen, four different winds must what? Combine and begin to what? To spin. I hope some Americans are listening to me. Four different winds must combine and begin to what? Spin. So when we get into March, April, May time, when the tornado season comes and there's a tornado watch in your area and four winds are combining to spin to destroy and take life, this is how you pray. You make an appeal and ask the angel of the altar, the one that descends, that ascends from the east, that has the seal of God, that has the power to stop a combination of winds. Now, how does hurricanes form? Before hurricanes form, it's just rain and thunder and lightning. But the moment they begin to spin, the four winds have what? Combined. And then the prince of the power of the air will then sit on it and can destroy if believers don't pray. I'll leave that one there. Let's move on.
Having the seal of the living God, and he cried with a low voice to the four angels to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea.
So the assignment of the four angels was to hurt what? The earth and the sea. They had power. And the power they had in their hand was the power of wind. And the wind can hurt the sea and hurt the earth. But this angel came and gave another commandment that made these ones to wait. Move on to the next verse.
Saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads.
Now, notice the language of this high-ranking what? Angel. There are angels and there are super angels. But let's just watch the humility with which he talks. Okay? He didn't come and say, you guys, shut up. You don't know anything at all. I'm the boss and I'm telling you, you got to wait for me to do my work first before you can do your work. That was not the attitude. Now, I want to point out something to you. Verse 3, he says, saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, because he knew they could. They have the authority, they have the power to hurt the sea, the earth, and the trees. Till we, which means the angel that ascended from the east was not one. He had his own team. Till we have sealed the servants of our God. He tells the other angels, you know, it's our God. It's not just my God. It's what? Our God. But we have to seal the servants of our God first before we can do these judgments. What level of humility? Don't just walk on people and use people because you feel you have a goal and you have somewhere you're going. This angel does not do that. He does not behave like that towards the other angels. It's our God. For example, we stand here to minister. I don't go into prayer and into studying the word of God looking for scriptures to attack people. That's foolishness. That's not what I do. So for example, if I stand here and I preach a message and the message sounds like it's talking about you, most likely it's talking about you. Do you understand? Because I don't have the time, the energy to waste my life to sit down for 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 hours, sometimes a whole week preparing this message to attack people. That's foolishness. Because on the final day, I have to give an account. But then if the message comes, well, I miss the days in church when the pastor can freely preach. And then the churches can just go into prayer. Because I don't think, do you know how many times I had all kinds of messages from my pastor? I would just take it and just pray about it and became better people. The Western world has a problem. So eventually, pastors began to drop the message because if it says there, A is going to say he's talking about me. And if it's B, says so. So eventually, you don't have anything to preach because every scripture you quote is against somebody. That's not the gospel. And Paul wrote to the church and said, the gospel does offend. He said, if you preach the gospel and everybody loves you, then it's not the gospel. It's gospel to heal the saints. Gospel. That's why it is. Read verse 4.
And I heard a number of them which were sealed. And there were sealed 144 and 4,000 of all the tribes of the chosen of Israel.
Now, stop there. Now, I want you to understand, before I explain that, I want you to go to Romans chapter 11, verse 4. Romans chapter 11, verse 4. Read Romans 11, 4.
But what saith the answer of God unto him? I have reserved to myself 7,000 men, who have not bowed the knee to the image of Baal.
Now, this is not the first time God has set people for his own name's sake. Elijah thought he was the only one. And Elijah thought he was the only one that was a man of God. He was the only one preaching the truth. He was the only one that fighting against Baal worship. He was the only one that... And God said, sorry, Elijah. Sorry to bust your bubble. But you're not the only one. I got 7,000 prophets that have not bowed down to Baal. And Elijah was in shock. Now, you got to understand that Elijah is a prophet. He was a prophet of God and might have thought that he knows everything about God. And God comes and tells him, you don't know anything about me at all. I got 7,000 people. You're just my spokesman. I got 7,000. You're just my spokesman. So, for example, if I stand here and I teach, and you think, oh, what a wonderful teaching. I'm not the only one that's teaching this kind of thing in Barbados. There's somebody teaching in another corner. We don't know anybody. We don't even know his name. He might not even be on Facebook. He might not be on Zoom, but he's preaching the same word and warning people. And because we don't see, we think we're the only ones doing the work of God. What foolishness. God has 7,000 people. This is why you need to be very careful. The moment you get to a point in your Christian life where you cannot be corrected, you cannot be rebuked, you cannot be spoken to because you've arrived, it's a very dangerous place because there are 7,000 ready to replace you. 7,000 ready to what to replace you. God has a plan. And as we study this, you will see the dangers. Now, 144,000. These 144,000, we're going to read more and find out who are they. 144, because a lot of people have heard all kinds of things about 144,000. Others believe the 144,000 have already come and gone. Others believe that it is them. I want to tell you, none of you at the sound of my voice is part of the 144,000. None of you. is part of the 144,000. I'm not part of the 144,000. I can prove it to you by scripture. And I want you to continue.
Verse of, of the tribe of Judah were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Reuben were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Gad were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Issachar were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Naphtali were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Manasseh were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Simeon were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Levi were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Issachar were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Zebulun were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Joseph were sealed 12,000. And of the tribe of Benjamin were sealed 12,000.
Now, 12 tribes. Out of every tribe of Israel, 12,000 people were sealed, which means the rest of Israel were not sealed. The question is, why did God choose to seal them? It's not the first time God has sealed. When we studied the book of Ezekiel, people were sealed too. It's the way of God. They were sealed for kingdom work. It's not because it does not mean that 144,000 were the only people that were saved. It didn't say saved. It said sealed. They were sealed for a purpose, to evangelize, to bring the gospel, send the gospel to the whole world. Why will God seal 144,000, 12,000 out of each tribe to go all around the world in the time of the tribulation to preach the gospel? Because the church will not be here. The preaching of the gospel have always been the mandate of the church. Go into the world and what? And preach the gospel, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them all things that I have taught you. That's the assignment of the church. And then he tells them, starting in Jerusalem, preaching Jerusalem, preaching Judea, preaching Samaria, unto the uttermost part of what? The world. But the church did not complete the assignment. So he raises up a people that will preach the gospel in the time of the tribulation. 144 Hebrew evangelists. Now, God does something. Now notice that in verse 5, he starts with Judah. Why didn't God start with Reuben? There's a reason. Reuben lost his birthright. Because in the day of their father Reuben, Reuben went and slept with his father's wife. So the honor of birthright of a firstborn, he lost it. You can lose your birthright by your sin. Some of you are not convinced. Let me show you scripture. Go to 1 Chronicles chapter 5. 1 Chronicles chapter 5. Now remember, Jacob cursed Reuben, that Reuben will not excel, in Genesis chapter 49. But then Moses, being a prophet, understanding what Jacob had done, reverse the curse, and so that Reuben will have inheritance. And though the curse was reversed for Reuben to have inheritance, Reuben did not get his honor back. Sins can be forgiven. The consequences of sin can be forever. For example, somebody goes, a child of God goes and gets pregnant. He comes to God and in tears repents and say, God, I'm so sorry. I fell into sin. Forgive me. God will forgive you. God will clean you, sanctify you, pour his Holy Spirit inside you. But I want to tell you, your belly will still grow bigger. You'll still end up at the maternity ward. Everybody will know that you had a child out of wedlock. That's the consequences. So sins are forgiven, but the consequences of sin are a whole different story. Now read 1 Chronicles chapter 5, verse 1 and 2.
Now the sons of Reuben, the firstborn of Israel, for he was the firstborn, but for as much as he defiled his father's bed, his birthright was given unto the sons of Joseph, the son of Israel.
Do you see that? His birthright was given to who? The son of Joseph. Jacob switched the birthrights. Because Reuben was the firstborn. Number one, he slept with his father's wife. Number two, he told lies that Joseph was killed by the wild wood animal. And his father said, I'm done with this boy. He switched their birthright by prophecy. Be careful. Be careful. Destinies can be switched. I repeat, destinies can be what? Can be swayed. Jesus prayed 40 days and 40 nights, and he chose 12 disciples, and they went out to preach the gospel, and they came back and said, we saw Satan fall as lightning. He said, rejoice not, but rejoice that your names are written what? In the book of life. And in another place, say, there shall be 12 thrones, and 12 of you shall sit on the 12 thrones of Israel and judge Israel. While he was speaking, Judas was part of them. But Judas, Bishop Red, was taken over by who? Matthias. You can be replaced. Now that's not all. You didn't finish. Finish reading.
And the genealogy is not to be reckoned after the birthright. For Judah prevailed above his brethren, and of him came the chief ruler, but the birthright was Joseph's.
So what Jacob did was he split responsibility. He made the birthright, which is a blessing in his own, he gave that to Joseph. And then the leader of among them, he gave that to Judah. So Reuben was left with nothing. May that which belongs to you before the foundation of the world not be given to another person in Jesus' name. May you not be found in a place because of arrogance and pride and stubbornness that you will lose your estate. That your estate will be given to somebody else. Now, I wanted to pay particular attention to this scripture. You will notice that the tribe of Dan is not there. Some of you are not observant. Look at that. The tribe of Dan is not mentioned. And the tribe of Ephraim is not mentioned, and Dan is not mentioned. Why? But you will notice that in the dividing of the land and giving inheritance in the book of Joshua, the Levites were not given landed inheritance. Their inheritance was of the Lord. They were not given landed what? Inheritance. In the dividing of the tribes to go to war, and I've taught this, that it, when it is in the form of a cross, Levi stay what? In the middle. And Joseph is split into two tribes, Manasseh and what? And Ephraim. But when it came to God choosing evangelists to go and preach, he leaves out Dan and he leaves out Ephraim. Why? And then he replaces Ephraim with Joseph and replaces Dan with Levi. You can be replaced. You know, because of lack of teaching and everything, now people going about and saying, my purpose, my calling, and my destiny. My friend, be careful. Work out your own salvation with fear and what? And trembling. Everything we do is just by grace and by His mercy. Don't get arrogant. Don't get over yourself thinking that you know everything. You can be replaced. Now, let me give you a scripture why God did what he did. Go to Genesis chapter 49, verse 17. Genesis chapter 49, verse 17.
Dan shall be a serpent by the way, an adder in the path, that biteth the horse's heels, so that his rider shall fall backward.
Jacob is another level of a prophet. He's a patriarch. Jacob could see that Dan will bring trouble in the kingdom of Israel. And when you study the tribes, when you get to the book of Judges, one day we'll study the book of Judges, you will notice that it was the tribe of Dan that brought idolatry into the land when they entered the promised land. And God never forgets it. It was the tribe, in fact, when Joshua divided the land, they were given the coastal region of the Mediterranean. They woke up one day and felt that they don't like that land and that they wanted to go to the Phoenicians where they are and everything, and conquer there. And then they brought all their idol worship to it. But Jacob, being a prophet, foresaw what they would do. And that's why he said, they are a venomous viper by the path that bites. May that not be said of you in Jesus' name. Now, let me show you why God also judged Ephraim. Go to Hosea chapter 4, verse 17. Hosea chapter 4, verse 17. Hosea chapter 4, verse 17.
Ephraim is joined to idols.
Do you see that? Ephraim is joined to what?
Idols.
Continue.
Let him alone. Their drink is sour. They have committed whoredom continually. Her rulers with shame do love, give ye. The wind hath bound her up in her wings, and they shall be ashamed because of their sacrifices.
So now I've shown you Dan, and I've shown you what? Ephraim. If you like, go and do a personal study on the tribe of Dan and see what they did in the book of Judges. It will surprise you. They caused a lot of trouble in the kingdom of Israel. So God dealt with it. Why did God deal with that? Go to Deuteronomy chapter 29. Deuteronomy chapter 29, verse 18. Deuteronomy chapter 29, verse 18.
Lest there should be among you man or woman or family or tribe whose heart turneth away this day from the Lord our God to go and serve the gods of these nations. Lest there should be among you a root that beareth gall and wormwood. And it come to pass, when he heareth the words of this curse, that he bless himself in his heart, saying, I shall have peace, though I walk in the imagination of my heart.
You see that? I will have peace, though I walk in the imaginations of my heart. That's the state of the world. You know, liberty. Liberty to do whatever you like, but I will still have peace. No, you will not. Continue.
To add drunkenness to thirst, the Lord will not spare him. But then the anger of the Lord and his jealousy shall smoke against that man, and all the curses that are written in this book shall lay upon him, and the Lord shall blot out his name from under heaven. And the Lord shall separate him unto evil out of all the tribes of Israel, according to all the curses of the covenant that are written in this book of the law.
Do you see that? So God had to obey his own word. He needed to deal with their idol worshiping, because he had warned any person, any family, any tribe that aligned himself with idol worshiping, I will deal with that. I will take them out. And for the 144,000 that were going to go and evangelize the world, the tribe of Dan and the tribe of Ephraim were not good examples. So he left them out. But then he showed them mercy. Because when you go to Ezekiel chapter 48, and I'm not going to read that because we did Ezekiel. Ezekiel chapter 48 from verse 1, you will notice that Dan and Ephraim, in verse 1, Dan is included in landed inheritance, and Ephraim is included in verse 5. So when Jesus takes over in the millennium, he will pity them. The mercy and the love of God, but they lost honor Because it is an honorable thing for God to call you to do his work. That's why you should see it as a privilege and not as a burden to be called upon to do anything for God. I mean, who are we to be called upon to do anything for God? There are billions of people on this earth. The idea that God Almighty looked down on planet Earth and found you and me specks of dust and want to use us, when there are more academically astute people, more handsome people, beautiful people, he bypassed all of them and decided to use you for his glory. It's humbling. So that every time self wants to push you above where you are, deal with self. Notice that you don't pray that God should humble you. You'll be eating grass. That is what happened to Nebuchadnezzar. You never pray, because the Bible says, humble yourself. That even Jesus, he humbled himself even to the death of the cross. And because of that, Jesus, God the Father, highly exalted him and gave him a name above all other names. One of the challenges in the part of the world we live is people don't know how to serve and how to honor. And it comes from the philosophy we've been taught at school. The only reason why I know this is because I consider myself as very cross-culture. I was born in England, raised in Ghana, lived in England, lived in the Caribbean. So I'm very, very cross-culture. So I can see things from a different angles and different perspectives and know what is going on. What is going on. And we must learn these things that we don't become victims of our own self. Read verse 9.
After this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude, which no man can number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands.
Now, so after this I beheld, after what? After they sealed the 144,000 who went all over the world preaching the gospel. Now, because they were sealed, the Antichrist could not touch them. They were sealed to make sure, you know, at that time, you can't preach the gospel without being arrested and being killed and everything. So God had to seal some people who were sending the gospel everywhere in the world. They were sealed in the realm of the spirit. It wasn't a plaster on the forehead. It's a spiritual thing. And they went about preaching the gospel. And the Bible's making us to understand that after they preached the gospel, after this I beheld, after these 144,000 went all over the world, Jewish evangelists went all over the world preaching the gospel. Now, please understand, when the day of Pentecost came, it was Jewish men that stood up and preached the gospel. They began it, they will end it. The Jew first and the Gentile. It's always the patterns of God. The Jew first and what? The Gentile. If you don't like it, that's your problem. The Jew first and the Gentile. Salvation to the Jew first and the Gentile. That was the pattern. Now, in the end time, these 144 Jewish evangelists will go all over the world preaching the gospel of Christ, because finally they have accepted that Jesus is the Messiah. And they will begin to preach. And the Bible says when they begin to preach in the tribulation, in the midst of all the hunger, remember there's hunger. Remember there's war. Remember there is the food was being what? Measured. Remember that the situation was horrible all over the world. Now, remember that all these times, the mark of the Antichrist had not yet come to pass yet. So you're still free to buy things. We're not in Revelation 13 yet. This is just the first part of the 7 years. And the Bible makes us understand in these first 3.5 years, where these evangelists went all over the world preaching the gospel, many people will give their life to Christ. The greatest revival will be at the time of the tribulation. I just want to finish my time here first. They will preach the gospel in season and what? Out of season. Now, the result of their preaching is a great multitude, which no man could what? Could number. You could number the 144 evangelists. You can't number the number of people that gave their life to Christ as a result of their preaching. There were too many. Because many people will realize, hold on a second, this is my last word, opportunity. 25% of the world have just perished. Now I believe Jesus is the way. I want to give my life to Jesus. Now notice another thing. Of all nations, if you look around the world now, there will still find nations on this planet Earth where the gospel have not thrived up till now. Now, there are countries called the 1040 window latitude. That's a geography there. Where's my globe? Somebody bring me my globe. The globe. The 1040 window latitude. The countries, there's a principality that controls the 1040 window, that he does not allow the gospel to thrive there. And as you look on the map, that 1040 window falls of North Africa, all throughout Asia, Russia, and in those areas, the gospel has not entered. It's illegal to preach in these countries. So people preach at the perils of their lives. Morocco, Tunisia, Libya, all these countries, Mauritania. The gospel hasn't penetrated these countries. Mongolia. The gospel hasn't penetrated these countries. But then the 144 will send the gospel there. Have they done it before? Yes. You know, persecution forced the church to go all over the world to preach the gospel. Another persecution will force the church. The tribulation says, will force the tribulation says to go all over the world and preach the gospel. I don't know why God always have to allow persecution before we preach the gospel. Now, another thing in that verse that you need to take particular attention to is of all nations. Number one. Number two, of all kindreds, which means that kindreds represent tribes and peoples with black, white, yellow, green, it doesn't matter, short, tall. You know, God doesn't have a problem with race, you know. God just sees human beings. Human beings are the people that make distinctions between this is black, this one is black, and that one is white, and this one has small eyes, and that one has big eyes, and this one is tall. God doesn't see that. He sees a bunch of human beings. He died for humanity. His son shed his blood for what? For humanity. He doesn't see color and creed. He doesn't see social status. He doesn't see where you come from. You know, some of you are very particular about accents. Do you know Jesus had an accent? Go and read your Bible. Jesus was born in Bethlehem, but he never had a southern accent. When his parents returned from Egypt, they didn't settle in Bethlehem. They went up north and they live in Nazareth. So he grew up with a Galilean accent. And on top of that, he learned the language of the Syrians. That's the language Jesus spoke. So he spoke Hebrew with a northern accent. So how do you know all of that? When they arrested Peter, they didn't arrest Peter. When they arrested Jesus, Peter, the Bible said Peter sat by the fire. And then a little girl came and said, "You are one of his disciples." "I'm not one of his disciples." And another person came and said, "Of a surety, you are one. You have a Galilean what? Accent. You have a Galilean accent. You are one of his disciples." Wherever you come from, there is an accent. Now, many people know that English is spoken in England, right? London, as the capital of England alone, has three distinct accents. Three in London as a city. If you were brought up in North and Eastern London, you have a different accent, the Cockney accent. If you were brought up in South London, you have a different accent. And if you're brought up in posh West London, well, you got the Queen's accent. Three different accents, same language. Oh, they get worse. By the time you start traveling north and you get to Birmingham, that's how they pronounce it. They don't say Birmingham. They say Birmingham. The accent begins to change. By the time you get to Yorkshire, Lord have mercy, has a completely different accent. Manchester. I have a niece that lives in Manchester and pick up the Manchester accent. It is just horrible. But she speaks in a Manchester accent. Now, if you think Manchester accent is horrible, try Liverpool. Liverpool is the worst I've ever come across. I haven't got a clue what they're talking about. Now, seriously, my accent is better than Liverpool accent. That on TV, on British television, they don't employ people with a Liverpool accent to read the news. That's how bad it is. Now, let's come to Barbados. By the time you start from St. Lucie, the accent is different from the rest of the country. You see my bag? You found my bag? I'm looking for my bag. They don't say bag, they say bag. They don't say Sunday, they say Sanda. I didn't see you on Sanda. And I'm thinking, what? But because they used to that, it's normal what? To them. And then as you come in south of Barbados, the accent changes. But then if you go into the heavily populated areas like Bass Rock and you enter New Orleans, it has its own accent. They will speak, you just go, who? You don't have a clue what they're talking about. By the time you get to the East Coast part, they got their own St. Joseph. They got their own accent in that place. It's different. Now, narrow it down to social status. The school you attended affects your accent. When I meet people who went to school in Harrison College, there is a way to pronounce their words. And those that went to Cumbermed, there's a way to pronounce their words. And the ways that went to Queen's College. And the rest of the people have their own accent. Because these schools were created for social norms. They have their own accent. But it doesn't matter to God. It does not what? It does not matter to God, because all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be what? Saved. Whether you got an American accent, it's the people talk about an American accent. Do you know how many accents is in America? New York has its own accent. Florida has its own accent. Texas has its own unique accent. Did you notice how George W. Bush spoke? But I want to tell you how the American forces in Iraq. Well, Trump does not speak like that because Trump is from New York. Two different accents, same country. God doesn't care about that. Have you been born again? Have your sins been washed what? In the blood. That's what that matters. But even in the church, the same mistake is made. That sometimes we think how posh somebody speaks is anointed. And American preachers get away with that a lot. Well, I want to tell you, God is gonna do it. And that's just a style of preaching. It's not anointing. Can I tell? It's not. It is not. I've seen people that don't have all of that. Pray 5 minutes. 5 minutes and people jump out of wheelchair. Do you know Reinhard Bonnke? For all the years he spoke in English, that Reinhard Bonnke is from Germany. Do you know Reinhard Bonnke? Of all the years he's preaching English, still had a German accent. God doesn't care. Oh, and in many years he preached in Africa, we didn't care about it. As long as the power of God and people were getting saved. Can't you see Benny Hinn still have an accent? He still got his Arabic accent. Doesn't matter. It's not about where you're coming from, what you are doing, it's what is inside you. That's all that matters. So some people go, did you mean this word that you were trying to pronounce? Is it this word you were trying to pronounce? When you get to New York International Airport and you begin to speak your Beijing English, right there, the security officers will look at you and say, can you speak English, please? That's what they will tell you. You'll be shocked. Yes. Scottish accent, Irish accents, different accents. The Australian accent is quite different from British accent. Same language. Canadians have their own accent. Same language. All those things are lighter matters of the law. Don't concentrate on those things because you can concentrate on that and miss a revelation just because it did not come in the package you're looking for. They stood before the throne and before the Lamb and were clothed with white robes and palms in their hands. Why? Because many of them that will get saved during the tribulation will also be killed. Their matter is, you get saved, you get killed, you appear before God. Welcome to the time of the tribulation. So they will be wearing white robes, not on earth. They will get saved of great nations, but they will stand before the throne because they will be killed. They are tribulation saints. That is why we say to you that now to give your life to Christ, this is a good time to give your life to Christ and live for him. Even for revival, people that I want to see revival in Barbados. I want to see revival in this part of the world. Do you know the price of revival? Now I hear people say they want to see revival. And then I watch people. And I know they're not ready for a revival. Revival costs. Revival will take all your life. Revival will change what you eat, how you sleep, where you go. It will change everything. I got born again in a revival, and I can tell you, in a revival, you got to be on your toes, man. Those were the days that the Spirit of God will wake you out of bed and say, go preach the gospel. He said, why are you doing the Spirit of God will nudge somebody at the same place he told you to go and preach, you will get there and somebody's already preaching. You will be replaced. Oh, and you preach all that and everything? Ain't nobody going to praise you for that? Because you're working for the Lord. Nobody. That's revival. In a revival, altar calls are different. People come to altar calls and they can be on the floor for hours praying for repentance. Would you be willing to wait for them to finish praying? Because that means while service is meant to end at 9 o'clock, service, they could be on the floor for 1 hour. Revival costs. Oh, in a revival, people that are in the demonic world, that are into palmistry, sorcery, witchcraft, they come and they give their life to Christ. All of a sudden, you need a whole deliverance team. And not that alone, you need a whole people, you need a number of people who is going to teach new believers class and nature them in the faith. Are you prepared to pay the price? Cost. In a revival, God can send you anywhere. And you know that where you are going, you might not return. I told you the story when we went in a Muslim dominated, we knew we could be killed, but we still went. Because a soul must be saved. You prepared to do that? You know, I know some of you are not prepared for that. The things you focus on. Oh my goodness. And this one said, and this one, let me tell you, that's what I call pettiness. Because in a revival, there is more at stake than that. Have you ever wondered why Peter, James, and John told us, said, we cannot leave the word of God and pray. We shall give ourselves continually unto what? Unto prayer and to the ministry of the word. It's not good for us to share tables. But the Bible says that the widows and the women were arguing that only the Jewish women were being looked after and that they were not, their needs were not being met. Brethren, look among you. They didn't have time. There was a revival. They didn't have time. And then he said, find 7 men that are among you that are filled with the Holy Ghost. We'll lay hands on them and appoint them to this kind of work. We don't have time for that. In the revival, you don't see the preachers. They come, they preach, signs and wonders happen, they go back into the closet. The preacher doesn't come, set up, talk, chat, nah. It's a price to pay. And you know something about revival? The people are not offended. They're not. They know. As long as we let pastor to spend more time with God, he comes back with God. Yeah, what I said. As long as we let pastor to spend time with God, he comes back with who? God. They'll stand there, they'll pray. I've seen people stand there, pray 1 minute prayer. Blind eyes open. My own youth pastor. He's still alive. And all he prayed was, Father, in the name of, I'm repeating his prayer because I remember. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, I command that blind eyes open in Jesus' name. Pow. That was it. And the distance between where he was standing and where that blind man was standing was like that house across the street. No anointing oil, no handkerchief, nothing. He just stood at the pulpit, announced it, and it was so. You know why? Because they paid the price for revival. Revival cost. And I'm trying to raise a generation that will understand what it means for revival. What it means for revival. Some of you have to go back to God and say, God, fix me. Maybe you need to listen to that young man's song. Fix me, fix me. You need to go back and say, God, fix me. Fix me. Change my mindset. It's a mind thing. It's a mind thing. Let this mind of Christ what? Be in you. It's a mind thing. I can't help you with that. You just need to study the word of God and say, Lord, my mind, I don't think like Jesus. Help me. Help me to align my mind like Christ. It's crucial. It's crucial. Help me to align my mind with Christ. Because if you don't do that, you will miss out. We're not preparing to be revivalists in this time. We must be revivalists now. That's why we are called this generation. We are not called that. People call us all kinds of things. That generation. Some people call it last generation. We are not the last generation. We are not that generation. We are this generation. This is the generation that seek God. Why? Because we want to see revival in our day and in what? In our time. It must happen in our time. There's never been a notable revival in the whole of the Caribbean. That's why doing the work of God in the Caribbean is hard. Because there's no reference point about how revivals look like. Go back to God. Say, God, it must happen in my generation. Because it is prophecy that the islands of the sea, that in the last days, God's focus will be the islands of what? The sea. And before the earthquake that will move islands around, we must have our revival. Amen. Somebody say amen. But we must change our mindset. Must change our mindset. Listen, try this week. Let me give you an example. Try this week. I've been trying to cope up. Papa's been busy. But it doesn't mean anything to me. It doesn't mean it does not care about me. You understand what I'm saying? You need to improve your mindset. Because otherwise we can't get anywhere. We'll just be dealing with petty things. Things that don't matter. It's very dangerous. You will not make progress that way. Verse 10.
And cry with a low voice, saying, salvation to our God, which sitteth upon the throne, and unto the Lamb. And all the angels stood round about the throne, and about the elders and the four beasts, and fell before the throne on their faces and worshiped God.
And they worship God. The agenda in heaven is only one. To do what? To worship God. When I look at ministry, this is what I want. The agenda is to worship who? God. Now, can you see sometimes we do posters and my picture is not there? It's not because if I put my picture there, it's a sin. I'm the pastor. If I put my picture on the poster, it is not a sin. But many times I leave my picture out. Because I want us to bring us to focus. The focus is on who? God. The Lamb of God that sits upon the throne. That's the focus. Their focus was to worship him. The angels, the 24 elders, their focus was to worship him. That's all their focus was. When we lose our focus, anything can distract you. Antonio, I wanted to find that message I let you listen years ago and post it in this generation for us. Sidetracked saints. Find it. Sidetracked what? Saints. Preached by a Baptist hot preacher. He's still alive. You can be sidetracked by what? Anything. Be careful. And in the days and times we are, not everything that what? How do I put it? It's not everything that is shimmering like gold that is gold, you know. Can I tell you something? Some of my mentors were not as highly educated as I am. But I knew they were telling me the truth, so I listened. It will take you far. That man, Joseph Babalola, I will get his book for you to read. Up till now, the room the man used to pray in, they claim that when you enter, you still feel the presence of God. And the man has been dead and gone for about 50 years or so. That man went on the mountaintop to pray. A big snake came towards him. He said, I'm not living here until I hear God. and the snake climbed over him. By the time the snake climbed over him to the other side, the snake was dried up. Power. The snake was what? Dried up. People that knew the word and knew how to pray. And I don't want us to do ministry and become casualties of the ministry. That's why I teach the word of God the way I teach. So that we are balanced, knowing the word of God, and we are also people of what? Prayer. They worship God. And on Sunday, that's what we're going to do. Worship who? God. Just going to set some time aside and worship God as they worship God. Continue.
Saying, amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be unto our God forever and ever. Amen.
You see that? Blessing, glory, wisdom, thanksgiving, honor, power, might. They praise God for that. Next verse.
And one of the elders answered, saying unto me, what are these which are arrayed in white robes, and whence came there? And I said unto him, sir, thou knowest. And he said to me, these are they which came out of great tribulation and have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb.
Now, one of the elders asked John, do you know who these are? These large crowd you see, do you know who they are? You know. And then he told. John could have been arrogant and said, let me try and answer this elder. Because while I was on earth, Jesus took me on the Mount of what? Transfiguration. You know, my wife was sharing a story that one of the apostles in Nigeria was sharing. And he said, when they were growing up, there was one of them that every time they begin to pray, God will open his eyes. They will be listening to radio. He will be watching television. And he wanted to marry a young lady. And they said, we don't think this is the will of God. His response was, I hope you people understand that I am the one that sees. Arrogance. I hope you people understand that I am the what? The one that see. He went ahead and married that woman. And that was the end of him. All of them have become big. He's nowhere to be found. They even tried as Christian brothers to help that marriage. But everything that young man started, the woman squandered. Very sad story. Because at that point in time, he was the only one that was seeing. So he was a seer. You know, Barbados, we got people walking around. I'm a seer. Seer and not know the word of God. You will become a casualty of your gift. For the gift and calling of God is without what? Repentance. Be careful. Go to verse 15.
Therefore, are they before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple, and he that sitteth on the throne shall dwell among them.
Now people see these verses go, is there a temple in heaven? When is it in his temple? He's talking about his throne. The throne area is his temple. Where the 24 elders, the angels, the seven, remember there are 24 elders, and then there are the seven angels that stand before the throne. And then there are the four living creatures. And then there are the seraphims that are flying around. And then there's all kinds of innumerable number of what? Angels around the throne. What's the temple? He is the temple. Don't forget that we're learning that in home cell. He is what? The temple. Because our religious mindset, when we see there's a temple, we're thinking, when we say temple, the first thing we're thinking about is a building. That's not what he's talking about here. Verse 16.
They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more, neither shall the sun light on them, nor any heat.
When we get into his presence, There shall be no more hunger. There shall be no more thirst. There shall be no more lack. This is why you must press on and not let anything distract you. One day, Jesus wanted to preach the gospel and his own disciples wanted to distract him. He said, have you had anything to eat? Sometimes we are distracted by legitimate what? Things. And Jesus said, I must work the works of him that sent me. And night cometh when no man what can work. He knew he had a short time. He knew he had a short time. I don't have a long time. The world is running. And I must run. I must run. I must raise up people. I don't have time. I don't have a long time to waste. I must raise up young men, young women that are full of the Holy Ghost. Young men, young women that can preach the gospel. Young men, young women that when they open their mouth, the words that proceed out of their mouth will be spirit and life. Young women, young men that can stand and say, this is what we have heard. This is what we have seen. It is of that we testify of. Young men and young women that can preach and the lame can walk. Young women and young men that can preach, prophesy, speak the word of God, and it will not bother them. I'm not raising a group of people that want to become celebrities. The church is full of them. Full of them. You see me being introduced when I'm preaching? That we have to come and say, today we're just going to introduce Pastor. Pastor Stephen Tilton. His this, his that. You think all that is necessary? Nobody introduced Jesus. Nobody introduced Paul, Peter, and everything. And yet they came and they shook their generation. I am looking for some A.W. Tozers to shake a generation. I want to see God raise up some man, John Knox, that can pray and 10,000 people. The Queen, Prime Minister Mia Motley will hear of you and say, they say there's a young man in St. Lucy. They say there's a young woman in St. Thomas. They say there's a young person in St. James. But when he begins to pray, he's the one that's changing the atmosphere. He's the one that's changing the economy. That's the kind of people I want to raise. Don't forget our mandate. It's to raise her people who are of Job's caliber, who have money, but money is not in their heart. Sometimes I watch. I say, hey, Lord, have mercy. Money hasn't come yet, but I'm worried. I'm worried because some people get money, we cannot talk to them anymore. I'm worried because power hasn't come yet. Power comes, we can't talk to them anymore. That's not my mandate. It's not my mandate. My mandate is to raise giants. And I'll show some of you. That you guys are the fourth generation of young people I'm raising. If I want titles, I know how to get titles. I can get 3-4 titles and put it before my name before I get introduced. But when we get to heaven, there are no titles. You're called by your first name. Do you understand that Jesus was called as Jesus and he was not offended? Some called him teacher, he was not offended. Some called him pastor, he was not offended. Some called him rabbi, he was not offended. Others called him prophet, he was not offended. He was the son of the living God. Some called him the son of man, and so he was not offended anything they called him because he was focused on what he was born for. I'm not here to raise a generation that are fighting to be somebody. I want to raise a generation that when people see you, they see Jesus. A young boy went to Sunday school many years ago and went home. And the parents asked him, how was Sunday school? See, Sunday school was great. Jesus was there. He said, what do you mean Jesus was there? He said, yeah, I know Jesus was there. He said, no, Jesus was there. He came to teach us. Because that young boy had been observing, looking. And he saw the humility that was in the Bible, the simplicity that was in the Bible in one of the children's teachers. And the young boy mistakenly took that teacher to be Jesus. That's where we want to be. And they took notice that the disciples are being with who? Jesus. I don't want people to take notice that you've been with me. You've been with me and you have no character. No, you've been with me, but you are incorrigible. No, I want to see you've been with me. Oh, we have taken notice that of indeed you are with this kind of pastor. No wonder. No wonder you know the word of God. No wonder you understand the word of God. But no wonder you are so anointed, you are so simple. That's why I carry myself simple. It's not because I don't know what other people know. Because I know here in the Caribbean, until you have a title of an apostle or a prophet, the thing the rest of the ministry gives, you don't know anything. Some of us started very young. September 2020 is 30 years in ministry. 20 years in pastoral work. I am not a baby. So I can help you to get to where you need to get to. Not a baby. One day I sat down with one pastor in Barbados. He said, tell me how long you've been in ministry. I said, I just started this generation. He said, no, not this generation. No. Tell me how long you've been in power. Because your depth of understanding and maturity, it cannot be 7 years. It cannot be. Then I told him. I would never have told him. But he was in a dark place. And everybody had walked away. But I didn't. It takes maturity to do that. Being simple does not mean you're foolish. Being simple does not mean you don't know anything. There are empty barrels walking around making noise. When you can shout, does not mean you know anything. It's a great thing. That baobab tree, do you know how long it's been there in front of corporate affairs? Been there for years. I'm sure it's older than all of us in Barbados, but it's still there. All kinds of wind, storm, thunder, and lightning have come. It's still there. Grounded in the soil. Have you ever wondered why preachers come, preachers go, and people like Charles Stanley is still there. Charles Swindon is still there. And these guys don't even have, they don't have demonstrative gifts. They only have teaching gifts, but they are solid in what they believe. And God honors them. I look at the charismatic circles. Somebody comes out. Whee! And the next thing you hear is what? Bam! No depth in the word of God. That is not the kind of people we are raising in the name of Jesus. Somebody say amen. It is not our ethos. It's not our ethos. Not. You should be able to be loved, anointed, empowered, packaged without drama. Without drama. A young lady started ministry in America and he was helped by an old man. This old man is flawed, but the old man loved the young lady and helped him. That nobody knew this young lady in ministry. It was the old man that helped her name to what? To go all over. When he became big, he put the old man somewhere else. It was not long. It didn't even last 5 years. He was back on his face. And he has never recovered to the level and the honor she used to have. Be careful. There was a great man of God. His name is Archbishop Benson Idahosa. He was an old white man, a missionary in a village that helped him to become who he was. Very key. That's the kind of people we want to raise. So as we prepare, read ahead, Revelation chapter 8. to see what's going to come. But prepare yourself for Sunday, that the Lord will not pass you by. The Lord will not pass you. America is not an example for us. The Bible is the example for, I repeat, America is not what? An example for us. Let me tell you something. Many years ago, black people preach without drinking water. We copy many of these things all from America. Because black people don't easily get dehydrated. We saw the whites drinking water. White people get dehydrated. It's natural. We then copied it. It's all now fun to do. Copy everything. We must arrive in a special car. Our Bible and luggage must be put in another car. People must sing our praises. Honor us. That's what we call honor. Because we got people around here telling us how good we are. The same people who say Hosanna, Hosanna to Jesus were the same people who say crucify him. The same people who say crucify him. Be careful. Many of these things, I see a lot of things. I'm not moved. I'm not impressed. And I'm not going to copy them. I will remain simple, package simple. When I stand, I preach on with authority and with power. That's the key. Jesus. Do you know Jesus? Don't you know Jesus is God? And he sat down and he baked bread and fish for his disciples, whom he created. Don't forget he created them. And he still cooked for them. And he did not reduce who he was. If somebody passed me by, and does not say pastor, and the rest of the day I blow up like a balloon, I am a baby. Because when I get to heaven, nobody will address me as pastor. You understand what I'm saying? Mari Cerullo, as great as he was, they call me Brother Cerullo. Because we see him in heaven, that's what we will call him. Simple man, packaged with power. Look at men like Benny Hinn standing, miracles happening and power flowing. Still calls himself Pastor Benny Hinn. And got people that have never healed a headache. And they got all the titles piled up. That is not our example. Go after God. Get God inside you. Be packaged and still remain humble. Daniel, do you know? Oh, Holy Ghost, help me here. Do you know Daniel had all that revelation? And the Bible says he fell down and he was sick. And the Bible says, Daniel said, and I rose up in the morning and I went and said the king. Some of you would have opened church. After the abundance of revelation, he went and served what? The king. No wonder God used him. He went and served the king. Stand to your feet. Let's pray. Wanted to talk to the Lord in prayer. That in the days in which we are, as God is raising people, that your story will not be like Reuben. Your story will not be like Ephraim. Your story will not be like Dan. Among the tribe of Israel, nobody should take your bishopric. Nobody should take what belongs to you. Nobody. In the weeks to come, we're going to learn about Samson. Great man of God, but flawed man of God. Because he did not understand things that I'm talking about now. Please, let us not be casualties. The Bible says these things were written for our admonition and for what? Our correction. Lift up your voice and say, Lord, everything inside me that is not of you, that is fighting against your agenda, fighting against what you want to use me for, take it away from me. I don't want to end up like Dan. I don't want to end up like Ephraim. I don't want to end up like Reuben. But in the days you are raising up people, young men and young men across the Caribbean, for the revival that is to come. The Lord, I will not be left behind. Lift up your voice and begin to pray. Ask the Lord to speak to your heart. Ask the Lord to transform you and to change you. The Bible says, as many as I love, I rebuke and I resolve, I exhaust. If I don't love you, I will not rebuke you. If I don't love you, I will not correct you. Lift up your voice and pray. And say, Lord, help me. Help me in these times and these seasons. It's very tempting. I'm telling you, it is very tempting. I'm a pastor. I know what I'm talking about. It's very tempting. Very tempting. Very tempting to package yourself and see yourself as somebody that you're not. You're not. Everything is by mercy and grace. His mercy and grace. Lift up your voice and begin to pray. And say, Lord, help me here. That in this time and in this season, that you will not pass me by. You anoint me for this time and season. You grant me the grace to be humble. Bless me with money, and the money will be in my pocket and in my heart. Bless me with the grace to see, the grace to hear, that it will not make me arrogant. Ask the Lord to help you. The same God we serve, the same God that Mordecai said. Mordecai did all kinds of things for the king, and nobody praised Mordecai. Nobody honored Mordecai, but it did not change the character of Mordecai. It did not. Mordecai remained the same. No wonder the honor that was due him came. The honor that was due Mordecai came because it did not change him. He humbled himself. Christ Jesus, he humbled himself even to the death of the cross. It's not what you think you are. It's not about that. It's all about him. Is Jesus getting glory out of your life? If everybody is like you, if everybody is of the same character like you, would we get anything done? Would we get anything done? Lift up your voice and say, Lord, help me. You saved me for a reason. Sanctify me, purify my heart, change my life, mold my character. The gift and calling of God is without repentance. Flawed character will cost you. Ask the Lord to help you. In Jesus' name, we pray. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. God bless everyone. Amen.